Now, the moderator of this speaker is the Dean of the Nova Business School, Daniel Traça. Please help me welcome him. And then we are very fortunate that we have the European Commissioner for Research, Science, and Innovation here, and his name is Carlos Moedas. Please help me welcome him to the stage.
Thank you, Dirk. Thank you to all the previous speakers. It is a huge privilege for me to be here. It's a huge privilege for Nova SBE to be associated with these conferences. And I'd just like to make a few remarks before I pass the floor to the commissioner. I think there are two very important words that define these conferences. And these two words are dialogue and future. It is really this belief that there's a dialogue across generations, across peoples, across races, across religions, that this dialogue is the best way to build to trust and find the solutions for our future as a species. I hadn't seen that movie before, but I'd like all of you that are here, who probably were just warming up when the movie kicked in, to go back and take a look at that movie again. And that movie is very important to define something that I believe is absolutely critical, is that we are, as humanity, one. We have so much more that brings us together than that puts us apart. We have so many more similarities with other human beings than differences. And that is the first thing that you have to believe as a young person and build your dream around this. And the second thing is that because we have so much more in common than differences, it is when we get together and we discuss and we talk and we build dialogue that we create the solutions. So these conferences are exactly about this. The Youth Summit, the Estoril conferences are a place where we want different people to meet, different people to dialogue in order to build the trust and to find the solutions. I'm not saying there aren't any serious problems. There are serious problems, and some of them are quite difficult. But the important thing is to realize that it's only through dialogue that we address those problems. One of that problem, of course, has to, for Portugal, has to do with the future of Europe. We have gone through a very challenging crisis, and we need to build a stronger Europe. A stronger Europe is not just important for Portugal. A stronger Europe is not just important for Europe itself. A stronger Europe is absolutely vital to the future of humanity as a species. Okay? And so we need a Europe, we need a European project that will entail more peace, more scientific progress, more well-being, not just for Europeans, but for people from around the world. We've had a crisis in Portugal. Part of it is self-inflicted. Part of it comes from trends around the world. But we really must think through what Europe will look like. We must define its ambition, define its vision. We need to reestablish the trust that energizes the project, and we need to put forth a solution that will operationalize that vision. President Juncker has recently outlined 5 scenarios for the future of Europe. They highlight in a very stark way the choices that are had for each one of us, not just as a country, but the choice that are had for each one of you. And again, dialogue is also thinking about solutions. It's not just talking. If we just talk, we make no progress. If we talk and we focus our discussions on making progress and finding solutions, then we are creating progress. And so for Europe, it's the same thing. And we need to use this opportunity to talk, but also think very hardly about the solutions and the way forward. And each one of you, young and not so young, sitting in this audience, needs to have your opinion about what Europe will look like. Without Europe, there won't be a strong Portugal, there won't be a strong Europe, there won't be a strong world. And it's to talk to us about that, about the Europe of the future for young people, that we have with us Commissioner Carlos Moedas. Mr. Moedas has been European Commissioner for Research, Innovation and Science since 2014. He has served in the Portuguese government as Secretary of State to the Prime Minister from 2011 to 2014. And on that note, he has been on the receiving end of Europe. Now he has moved to the other side. So he has this tremendous ability to look at Europe from the point of view of the state and from the point of view of the European project. Before that, he's had an illustrious career in investment banking and was a senior economic advisor of the Social Democratic Party. It is a great privilege to have you back in Portugal. It is a great privilege to have you back at the Estoril conferences. And we look forward to listening to what you think for the young people here, how Europe will actually become a part of the future that each one of them wants to build. And like President Kennedy once said, not just what Europe can bring for him or for her, but also what each one of us in Portugal can contribute to this absolutely glorious project of the last 50 years that is Europe. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Daniel. Good morning. What a great pleasure to be here. Thank you to all of you for inviting me. Thank you for talking about Europe in the future. But I'm here to talk to you. And to me, youth must be cherished. Robert Kennedy once said something that really struck me. He said that this world demands the qualities of youth, not a time of life, but a state of mind, a temper of the will, a quality of imagination, and the predominance of courage over timidity. Each of you here today is special, and you have something in common. It's the time you're living in. Last year, in Germany, former President Barack Obama said that if you had to choose a moment in time to be born, any time in human history, you would choose today. And I think he's completely right. Right. But you know that is difficult. Right, but we're going through very, very hardships. We're going through a financial crisis, through a refugee crisis, through the terrorism, through the Brexit crisis. We're going through polycrisis, but I still believe that overall, if you had to choose a moment in time to be born, it would be today. So let me tell you first why I think that's so unique, this moment in time. And let me tell you, secondly, why you should not take for granted the life you have. And third, I want to ask you something for the future. So let's put it first in relative terms. Why now? What's so special about life today? And one of the men that I really liked was a man that died this year, a Swedish statistician called Hans Rosling. And you know, people always talk about the old good days and how the past was great and how life was amazing. And he, Hans Rosling, at some point he started basically showing that this idea that the past was good, that the past was better, was totally false. There's no good old days. You are the days. He showed that deaths from natural disasters are today less than a half than they were in the 1900s. He showed that the percentage of people dying in extreme poverty globally has decreased. We have taken more than 1 billion people out of poverty. And the likelihood that you will reach 100 years old is 3 times higher than your grandparents, which is amazingly cool. But it's not just quantity over quality. These days, you experience life in a completely different way than in my generation. You're more connected than ever. You're connected to everything. As a Portuguese, I love the story of Ferdinand Magellan. When Magellan's ship circumnavigated the globe, it took him 3 years, and he died in the middle of the trip. Today, you could do that in a day. You could go digitally wherever you want. You can talk to everybody around the world in a minute. You could even do it in a plane around the world propelled by solar energy like Bertrand Piccard. But if we narrow our gaze to Europe only, it's the same story. This year the EU celebrates 60 years. Since then, Europe has seen unprecedented levels of peace as we've never seen before since the past Peace of Westphalia. For 400 years, we had wars in Europe, and finally, we have peace. So as a European Commission, I am incredibly proud to see a union that has promoted the values that I cherish so much, human dignity, democracy, equality, solidarity, in the past 60 years. And our continent may be small, but it punches above our weight. We are just 7% of the population, and we produce 34% of the world's science. In the 16 most equal countries in the world, 14 are here in the European Union. But don't take it for granted. These are some of the reasons why I think now is the best of times. But you have to think that we are declining, that Europe is changing, that our power influence is changing. 20 years ago, we represented 30% of the world GDP. Today, we just represent barely 20%. And China went from 2% to 17%. So we have to deal with that. We have to think about how we can change the future, and the future will be changed by your generation. But let me tell you, when I think about my generation and what I remember when a wall divided the people of Berlin. I remember when Schengen was not yet a reality and you had to check in every border. You had to show your passport in every border of Europe. And I remember in this country when my father was a journalist and he could not write what he thought because he was afraid to go to prison. So you don't remember that time, but you have to fight for that time not to come back. And it's difficult because you feel that your life is normal, that what you have is just what you deserve, and you deserve it, but you cannot stop fighting. You see, when people look at what we've done, when you think about what you travel today, when you think that next month you'll have no roaming charges, you'll be free to call everybody in the European Union. That took a lot of work and that took a lot of hardships to get there. But it makes perfect sense that we have free movement, but fight for it, because you don't know the future. So imagine just if things went backwards, if we went from living in a time of free movement back to border controls. So considering these, I have a task for each of you today, because I think that each period of time has its own set of unique challenges. And this generation, your generation, is no different. My generation struggled to travel, to go to other places, to tackle the big and global changes. Generations before us had to deal with the world wars, and the generation after you, your children, will have their own unique challenge to rise. Last week, Mark Zuckerberg was giving the Harvard commencement speech, and he reminded me of a story that I really enjoyed and when I was a kid. My father was to tell me about this story of President Kennedy when he visited NASA. And when he got in, he saw a janitor cleaning with a broom. And he asked the janitor, "What are you doing, sir?" And the janitor looked at the president and said, "Mr. President, I'm helping put a man on the moon." And I think that somehow with the digital world, we have lost that kind of purpose. So as Mark Zuckerberg said, I think the biggest challenge of your generation is to create purpose for all of us. Your generation wants to build something with meaning, and your objective is to find meaning for all of us. Because technology is developing so fast, at such a speed, that we kind of feel disconnected. Why are we here? What are we doing for the future? And every day, I see great examples of your generation. And your generation will be the ones that will be able to tell us, no, we will use the digital world to connect millions of people to cure a disease. We will be the generation that will cure Alzheimer, that will cure cancer. We will be the generation that will change the economy from a waste to a circular economy with no waste. We will co-design cities together to reduce pollution. That is your generation, because your generation cares as no other generation. The other day I met this Dutch boy, Boyan Slat, that when he was 16, he went to Greece and he saw so many plastic bags in the sea that he decided himself, with 16 years old, to raise funds to clean the oceans. Today he has raised more than 15 million euros to raise oceans because he has a purpose. The purpose of cleaning the ocean. Nobody believed, my generation didn't believe. Why this young kid, he just dropped out of university to clean the oceans and he created a new technique to do it and he did it. So ladies and gentlemen, let me conclude with these words. Not only do you have the power to shape the destiny of Europe, it's your responsibility. Now our shared future is yours to design. And it's your task to make sure that we create a world better than today. A world that does not go back to the darker days. A world with improved quality of life and a world where we are adequately prepared for the future technologies. I'm an optimist by nature. I have a complete faith that you will succeed. But when you doubt yourself, when you will look at the examples of others of your generation. So let me finish with the words of Mark Zuckerberg the other day. He said, every generation has its defining works. More than 300,000 people worked to put a man on the moon, including that janitor. Millions of volunteers immunized children around the world against polio. These projects didn't just provide purpose for the people, they gave a country a sense of pride. So now it's your turn to do great things. It's your turn to connect the digital world to the physical world by creating purpose to us all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Commissioner, for these very inspiring words. We have time for questions from the floor, but while we get organized, I'll just throw you one question to give time for the audience. Someone that was 80 years old in 2007 would be now 18. Some of those sitting here were probably 8, 9, 10 years old when the crisis started in Europe. You mentioned purpose. You mentioned the desire of the generation to find that purpose and to put all that strength to make that purpose come true. How should they think of Europe and of the European project as they build that purpose and as they try to make the world better from the energy that they are committing to that purpose?
I think that you're right, Daniel. I mean, from the last 10 years, we just lived through crisis to crisis. And these crises get us lost a little bit in the perspective of how important Europe has been in the last 60 years. So I understand that for some of you, you feel disconnected because actually Europe is disconnected from people. When I was young, I started to do an Erasmus program when I was very young, and that was my first connection to Europe. So I think that what you have to think is that today, whatever you want or whatever you do, there's no physical borders anymore. I mean, physical borders, they are what they are, but they're not gonna solve the problems of the world. The problems that you have to tackle, like climate or cybersecurity, environment, pollution, they don't respect physical borders. So there's nothing today you can solve alone as a country. You have to solve it at a different level, and that's Europe. The problem is that in these last 10 years, the discussion to solve the problems was quite schizophrenic, was about who does what. You know, you remember this financial crisis? In the US, it was basically solved in 1-2 years, because everybody knew what was at the federal state and what was at the national, or in that case, on the state level. In Europe, the discussion was about, oh, but who does what? Is it at the European level or is it at the national level? And it took us like 10 years to decide who does what. So it's very important, Daniel, in your point of President Juncker and the future, that we clarify what we do. Because most of you in the room, you don't even know what I do. You don't know how the European Commission works, or the European Union. So we have to clarify that in a way that you understand what Europe does and what the countries do. And if we don't do that, we're going to lose you. And I don't want that, because I think if we lose you, we're going to lose the European project. And if you lose the European project, your life will be very different than it is today. And you will have much more hardships than you have today.
Thank you. So we have space for questions from the audience. There are hostesses and hostess going around. There's a question right there. Microphone there.
Stan. Okay, thank you, Commissioner, for your very inspiring speech.
Could you please just say your name?
My name is Boji from CKJSB. And my question after I read the brochure was, what are the young people in Europe, their particular strengths that is relatively compared to Americans and from Asia, for instance, China? What do you see their unique strength that will help them to innovate and help them to change the world?
It's a very good question, and I travel through the 28 countries a lot, and I've lived in the US. So I can actually compare a little bit what I see in Europe to other parts of the world. And I think that the biggest asset that we have in Europe and that our young people have is that we have an amazing diversity of people. And that diversity that for a long time we looked at it as something that would be a negative, like we speak different languages. But it's not a negative. It's an amazing positive for innovation and creativity. Actually, people like at the Harvard Business School, Linda Hill, she has been studying diversity for 20 years, and she always tells me that diverse groups take a little bit longer to start working, and sometimes they don't, but when they work, they do much better. And that diversity is the story of Europe. And so that's where you see that all these amazing businesses that we create in Europe make a difference. But then we don't have money to scale them up, and they go to other parts of the world. But it's not because the ideas are not here. The ideas are all here, but we didn't, as politicians, we were not able to deal with the fact that we had to create incentives to scale up those ideas, to keep those ideas in Europe. But I think that we have the biggest asset for creativity and innovation. It's called diversity. And to be different is good. It's not bad. It's something that I cherish in all my teams. You have to have people from different religions, from different countries, with different ways of thinking. Yes, it's hard when you discuss for the first time. It's much more comfortable to be with friends that think the same way. But you know what? You're not going to change the world by thinking the same way. So take the pain at the beginning to be with people that you normally would not talk to, and you'll see that the results will be much better. So I think that we have that. We just have to scale it up.
Thank you. There's a hand up right there. And then there's another one right there, so you can get the microphone to speed things up. Someone over there had their hand up before? Yeah, right there. So take the microphone so that we follow up quickly. Yes, please. Please stand up and present yourself.
Oh, there's one there.
Is the microphone not there yet? Can you stand up? Someone had raised their hand over there.
Okay,
you go.
Hello. Thank you. My name is Mauro, and I'm really thankful for being here. It's my first time. My question is like, I'm really nervous, sorry.
I am too.
thank you. Like, you guys said we don't know what you guys do, and it's like kind of true. And if you think it's after we come here, mm-hmm. if we understand like what you guys do and how important this is for us.
Very good, Mara. Very good. Thank you for your question. Because I think that people don't realize today how important is in our daily lives Europe. And you know, when all these adventures started of Europe, people didn't know where we would get to. And today, everything in your daily life actually depends on a lot of things that we do in Brussels, but you don't know about it. And I think that if you look at this country as I knew it when I was your age, and then when we joined the European Union, that is what the European Union does. I mean, at the time when I was young, people would not care that much in my generation about the environment, about pollution, about what was our future in terms of the planet. And that was what Europe brought to Portugal in the 80s, was this awareness of the importance of environmental policies, of solving the problems of the future. That's something that without Europe, I think that we will see a very different picture. You know, if every country had its own rules for pollution, if its own country had the rules for water and the quality of the water you drink, this would be a very different Europe, not a great Europe. You know, in the year 2000, there was a big starting of a big problem that we still have today, which is antimicrobial resistance. The fact that antibiotics are not working anymore as they used to do. And at the time, the only way to solve it was not country by country, because country by country, you cannot solve this situation. And it was the European Union that started putting all the hospitals together to understand how much we were doing and how much we were feeding, for instance, animals with antibiotics. And was from there that every country could take steps to solve the problem. The Dutch, for instance, they discovered that they were feeding their animals with a lot of antibiotics, and that was bad. And so they were able to solve it. So Europe is kind of an umbrella where you decide what is the future in terms of policies that countries then can apply. And then you have to go to the countries and make sure that they apply that for the good of everybody. And I think that that's probably the best way to explain it, but still it's very unclear and most of the people don't see it in their daily lives. So because Europe is always on the background, so we have to come to the front and tell you what we do. And that's what one of my missions every day is, to explain Europe to people. I tell you, it's not an easy one, but it's very fascinating. And I think that in your generation, you will understand it better than in mine.
Thank you. There's a question right there, just behind you, please. Oh, yeah.
Is me?
Yeah. Oh, no, yeah, go ahead. Ahead. I'm just making sure the microphone gets there.
So good morning, everyone. First of all, Maru was right. This is really nerve-wracking being here.
No,
and I want to say thank you for your inspiring words and for this opportunity, because this is amazing. Being 17 years old on high school and having the opportunity to make your questions and listening for what you have to say, it's really, really incredible. And so you were saying that we have to stand up for causes and that we have to fight for what we believe in. But sometimes I think, okay, we think that education is the most powerful weapon for us to stand up for something. And so we keep studying and we keep going to university and doing masters and going, becoming doctors and all that kind of stuff. So we keep studying and studying and studying. And when we finally want to be on, and when we finally want to get a job, or when we finally want to say, okay, so I have been studying and I know what to do, can I please do what I want to? Everyone say, no, you don't have experience, or you're too young, or like Amish said, you're too naive. And so what can I do if I keep studying? I think I know that I can do something. I have beliefs. I want to make a change in the world. But what can I do in concrete if everyone say, you cannot? If no one gives us that opportunity, if European Union is like breaking, and I don't want it to break, I want it to keep. I want to have like 50 years and can say, okay, I live in the European Union. I live in a world that it's united for something. But this is breaking, and what can I do to make it fixed? What can I do if no one in European Union and all kind of institutions say, no, you're too young to be here. You're too young to make a difference. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good night.
Very good.
Just great. I'd just like to make a small comment to all those in the room for the two previous questions that for all the nerves that you say you have, you're doing a wonderful job. And thank you for contributing, please.
Very good. No, thank you. And it's a great question because I think that the difficult thing, I mean, I look at you and I think how jealous I am of your age. And if I knew what I know today, my life would have been so different. And probably what I'm going to say to you doesn't make any sense to you, as it probably didn't make sense to me at the time. I think that you normally, when you're at your age, you kind of follow people. You follow the advice of your parents, you follow the advice of your friends. By the way, I think the advice of your parents is always very bad because they are so risk averse that they will tell you always to go on the safest place. And that's not a good advice. But I think that you always follow others and you never follow what you feel. And you never follow your passion. And sometimes in between the age of 15 and 25, you kind of put your passions so inside of you because you're so afraid of telling. You are afraid of your own passions because you're afraid to fail, because you're afraid of what your parents will think, because you'll be afraid of what your friends will think. And I think that your job is to take that makes you tick, that passion that makes you different and not to be afraid. And that takes a lot of self-confidence. And that's why I think that the educational system should be about building that self-confidence. Because life is not about intelligence, it's about self-confidence, it's about wanting to do. And so I think that for me, or if I could go back, I would have followed my passion. And the other day I was in Armenia, in Yerevan, in one of the best examples of a school I've seen, a couple that decided to change Armenia and went there. They are an American-Armenian couple. And they created this school where they get the kids very young. And they just get the kids and they let the kids follow their passion. And so the kids don't follow any kind of subjects or disciplines. They just follow things that they love to do. And at some point, one of the teachers told me, you know, our mission is to get those passions that they are afraid to recognize, or that those passions that are so inside of them that they can't even deal with it. And I think that it's about that. Think about what you really like. Close yourself. Don't look at your friends or your parents and think, this is what I want. And if you want that, do it, push it, go forward, don't stop. And if you don't stop, at some point it will happen. It's a question of doing it, and believing it. And you know, fake it until you make it.
Thank you. Well, unfortunately, I'm getting a sign from over there that we need to wrap it up. So I'm going to really, unfortunately, I won't have time for an additional question. I'll just wrap up in 1 minute by saying that thank you very much, Mr. Commissioner, for being with us, telling us that regardless of what it looks like, these are still the best of times, telling us that Europe has been very important to get us to these best of times, and it will be very important to keep it going despite a declining influence. But I think the two most important words that came out of this session, after dialogue and future, are passion and purpose. The passion that each one of you needs to have and the purpose that each one of you needs to find. There was a saying by Buddha, which is that the purpose of life is to find your purpose and then to devote all your energy and commit it to that purpose. So I'd like to ask you before I leave, those of you that have found your purpose, to raise your hand. Look around, how few hands are up. So I'd like each one of you to leave this room with homework. And that homework is to find the purpose of your life, and once you do it, get the passion and put all your strengths to developing it. That's how humanity goes forward. That's how each one of you can contribute to that progress. Thank you very much.